Ora, viva! Muito boa tarde. Estamos muito felizes por ter aqui esta sessão no nosso pavilhão do conhecimento, nosso, vosso, que agora tem um nome novo, é bom que comecemos já a divulgá-lo. Chama-se PACO. E tem origem nos dois, na tabela periódica, nos dois elementos, PACO, paractinídeo e cobalto. Bom, mas o PACO vem aí para chegar, é um nome vivo, vibrante, novo, nestes 25 anos que a Ciência Viva está a comemorar este ano. E vejam lá, comemoramos 25 anos com muita juventude e muita irreverência. Até arranjamos nomes novos para este Centro de Ciência, o que é muito bom. Mas ter aqui esta sessão hoje, no Dia Nacional da Cultura Científica, é para nós um gosto muito, muito grande, porque Portugal já há 25 anos que celebra a Semana da Ciência e da Tecnologia. Logo após ter sido criado o Ministério da Ciência e da Tecnologia, foi logo lançado a Semana da Ciência e da Tecnologia e o Dia Nacional da Cultura Científica. Portanto, bem-vindos todos, todas. A minha colega Ana Noronha vai fazer as honras desta gestão, desta discussão, e que vai ser em inglês. Por isso, welcome to you here at the Pavilion of Knowledge, PACO. I would like to address a special words to Pelle, our friend from Finland. Thank you for coming, Pelle. It has been a long way working together, and I started in this field with you, so I'm grateful to your knowledge and everything you shared with me in this field of science centers and museums. And we know that abroad, because we are transmitting on streaming, there are some colleagues, some friends, some people full of curiosity following this discussion. I hope Gail Lord is, I hope she's in Toronto, Canada, following us. I don't know. Maybe yes. And if it is the case, bye-bye. Hello to you, Gail. But also to everyone who is following us. So, I would like to invite Ana Noronha. Ana, the floor is yours, and I will be there following the discussion with curiosity. Thank you.
Agora é meu vídeo. Good afternoon. We now have the pleasure to have a keynote that was sent to us, a registered message by our member of the European Parliament, Maria Manuela Leitão Marques. So please, your attention to her message, please.
Olá a todos e a todas, e muito obrigada pelo convite para estar com vocês hoje aqui. Tenho só pena de não ser aí. No início deste mês estive em Washington, numa delegação do Parlamento Europeu, para discutir a política e a regulamentação da inteligência artificial. Fomos ao Congresso, à Casa Branca, e reunimos com vários think tanks que se dedicam a esta reflexão. Fui no Comitê Especial, na delegação do Comitê Especial de Inteligência Artificial que temos aqui no Parlamento. O objetivo da nossa visita era discutir as pontes transatlânticas para a inteligência artificial, outras tecnologias digitais, incluindo, é claro, a investigação e a inovação. No entanto, não é por isso que menciono esta visita para iniciar esta minha intervenção. Na nossa reunião na Casa Branca, fiquei impressionada, muito bem impressionada, com o Gabinete de Política Científica e Tecnológica, um andar inteiro, mas um andar grande, bem ali ao lado da sede do poder, que garante que a ciência seja levada em consideração, seja tida em consideração nas decisões políticas do Presidente e da Vice-Presidente, espero também. Uma das iniciativas importantes que o Gabinete de Política e Ciência e Tecnologia está a desenvolver em relação à inteligência artificial é o chamado National AI Research Resource. É uma infraestrutura de computação e dados compartilhada que fornecerá aos investigadores e estudantes de inteligência artificial em diferentes áreas e disciplinas científicas o acesso a recursos de computação e dados de alta qualidade, incluindo partilha de laboratórios para teste de algoritmos, juntamente com outras ferramentas educacionais adequadas ao apoio ao utilizador. O objetivo desta iniciativa, não é, deste recurso nacional, é democratizar, facilitar o acesso a recursos tão importantes para todos os investigadores nos Estados Unidos, permitindo-lhes participar na exploração de ideias inovadoras para o avanço da inteligência artificial, e incluindo neste esforço comunidades, instituições e regiões tradicionalmente menos bem servidas ou mal servidas desses mesmos meios. Este é um exemplo muito interessante de mobilização e de partilha de recursos científicos e tecnológicos em que devíamos também pensar a nível europeu. Aí está um momento onde a centralização talvez valesse a pena e fosse mais produtiva que a dispersão em que vivemos. Enfim, salvaguardadas as devidas diferenças, aqui também no Parlamento Europeu temos um painel para o futuro da ciência e da tecnologia, importante, mesmo que não ocupe um andar, que é conhecido como CETOA e que tem como objetivo fornecer às diferentes comissões parlamentares da indústria, do mercado interno, do ambiente, das liberdades, enfim, a muitas delas e aos deputados, estudos imparciais, estudos independentes sobre a ciência e as novas tecnologias e promover a troca de ideias entre decisores políticos, que somos nós, e políticos e cientistas. Nesta legislatura, o CETOA tem estado focado nas tecnologias disruptivas, como a inteligência artificial, lá vem ela de novo, as tecnologias ligadas à transição verde e também tecnologias ligadas à qualidade de vida dos cidadãos europeus. Temos debatido os mais variados temas, sempre com bom conhecimento, com bons contributos de fora do Parlamento, como é o caso, só para dar alguns exemplos, do uso da nanotecnologia na medicina, do impacto ambiental do 5G ou da forma como podemos combater a desinformação, as chamadas fake news. Por exemplo, debatemos o uso da nanotecnologia para ajudar a combater o cancro, a lidar com bactérias resistentes a antibióticos e até acelerar as nossas respostas a futuras pandemias. Mas temos também que considerar os riscos e os problemas éticos que às vezes essas tecnologias trazem para as nossas sociedades. O mesmo, por exemplo, no uso de tecnologias de edição do genoma na agricultura, as quais, por um lado, trazem benefícios em termos de produção agrícola europeia, mas também colocam, uma vez mais, desafios éticos e para a biodiversidade que temos que considerar e devidamente avaliar. Na verdade, tudo isto não são mais do que exemplos do reconhecimento que a ciência tem sido fundamental para os enormes avanços que alcançamos nas nossas sociedades. Normalmente ela fica nos bastidores e nem sempre é lembrada quando se discutem os orçamentos, os nossos aqui em Portugal e também os nossos aqui na Europa. Na atual pandemia de Covid, isso tem sido uma exceção. Diria mesmo uma exceção muito útil. A corrida das vacinas mostrou que o investimento na ciência foi o que nos permitiu superar esse desafio e estarmos hoje vacinadas. Que pena seria se desperdiçássemos esta oportunidade para refletir sobre a importância da ciência e se deixássemos que os recentes investimentos em ciência fossem para o lixo ou fossem reduzidos. Na verdade, a UE sempre foi uma potência científica. Na década de 50, os pais e as mães, fundadoras da União Europeia, sabiam que investir na investigação era essencial para o sucesso das comunidades europeias. A Comunidade Europeia do Carvão e do Aço, a primeira a ser criada, que europeizou a espinha dorsal das economias do pós-guerra, tão importante também para prevenir novas guerras e garantir a paz, incluiu o financiamento da investigação no artigo 55 do seu tratado fundador. E a Comunidade Europeia de Energia Atómica, criada quando pensávamos que a energia nuclear era a solução para eliminar quaisquer necessidades e dependências energéticas, colocou a investigação como a sua primeira tarefa, logo no artigo 2º. 70 anos depois, a União Europeia continua a dedicar uma parte importante dos seus recursos à ciência e os resultados estão à vista. Programas de todas e de todos conhecidos, como agora denominado Horizonte Europa, mas não é o único, têm sido programas emblemáticos do nosso projeto político nas últimas décadas. Temos vindo a financiar investigação fundamental e aplicada em todas as áreas do conhecimento, com critérios de excelência, mas também tentando nivelar o campo de jogo científico na Europa, aproximar, criar coesão. Este último ponto, talvez não ainda com o sucesso que gostaríamos, mas mesmo assim, já com resultados positivos. E embora isso possa parecer óbvio para a maioria dos presentes que me estão a ouvir, vale a pena sempre repetir duas ideias fundamentais. Primeiro, a de que investir em ciência inclui investimentos em investigação fundamental e aplicada, ambas. As tecnologias mRNA, que nos deram excelentes vacinas contra a Covid-19, começaram com uma ideia não convencional no laboratório, que só tinha investigação fundamental a apoiá-la. E em segundo lugar, que investir em ciência inclui investimentos em todas as áreas do conhecimento, e não apenas nas chamadas tecnologias de ponta. Como mostra a crise atual, a biologia e a química podem dar-nos uma vacina, mas precisamos também de economia, da sociologia, das ciências do comportamento e até das artes para saber como convencer as pessoas a tomar essas vacinas. Então, e quanto ao futuro? O futuro, não é? Aquilo que nos une aqui hoje, o futuro da Europa. Continuar a ser uma potência científica é essencial para a União Europeia, como projeto em si mesma e também para todos os que vivem cá, para todas e todos os europeus e os seus padrões de vida. Sejamos francos, a ciência empolga-nos pelo conhecimento que produz e nos permite adquirir, mas ela é também uma questão de competitividade das nossas economias. A ciência é relevante para a existência de empregos bem remunerados aqui na União Europeia e para o acesso às melhores carreiras de todas e de todos nós e, em especial, dos nossos jovens, agora e no futuro. Voltando à inteligência artificial e ao digital, como sabem, é uma área que acompanho com especial interesse, quando montámos o programa INCODE para as competências digitais, aqui em Portugal, em 2017, e montámo-lo bem cedo, para padrões europeus, não nos limitámos à inclusão digital, que com certeza foi uma preocupação, nem à educação ou ao upskilling e reskilling da nossa força de trabalho. Incluímos também um eixo de investigação, o quinto eixo, que além do mais devia e deve alimentar todos os outros. Hoje, a nossa literacia digital básica tem de incluir saber o que é um algoritmo, o que devemos perguntar na companhia de seguros ou no banco se o nosso seguro ou pedido de crédito foi rejeitado. Mas não só. Se não investirmos na investigação do digital e da inteligência artificial, neste programa para as competências digitais, e se não o fizermos ao mais alto nível, ficaremos com as tarefas menores na nova economia digital. Ficaremos nós, em Portugal, e ficará a União Europeia, se não fizer o mesmo. A nível local, a investigação é ainda o caminho a seguir para garantir a resolução de questões sociais que incomodam, os europeus, as cidadãs e os cidadãos diariamente, desde a saúde ao design urbano. E temos também uma iniciativa muito interessante para esse efeito, a nova Bauhaus. Globalmente, é o que nos pode salvar de um desastre climático, ou garantir que a União Europeia continua a ser um ator global relevante, com economias fortes e estados de bem-estar social justos. Os resultados da Conferência sobre o Futuro da Europa mostram ainda que os cidadãos e cidadãs também veem a ciência, a investigação e a inovação como indispensável para garantir o seu futuro e o da União. Eu estava a ler as contribuições na plataforma digital da conferência e vi o lugar de destaque que a ciência aí tem. Encontramos, por exemplo, uma proposta para a criação de um Instituto Europeu de Investigação em Saúde e as competências também não são esquecidas. Há uma proposta para um programa de competências básicas em matéria de STEM. Como disse antes, a ideia de aumentar a nossa competitividade a nível mundial também lá está inscrita na plataforma. Em resumo e para terminar, não há futuro da Europa, ou pelo menos, nenhum futuro que valha a pena esperar se não investirmos na ciência, se não passarmos os resultados da investigação científica, os resultados desse investimento, quando relevantes, para a inovação e para a economia. Se não soubermos comunicar e partilhar com a sociedade em geral, também esses mesmos resultados, de modo a manter a sua confiança na ciência e naquilo que ela nos traz. Se não os transformarmos no motor de um desenvolvimento sustentável e inclusivo, para nós, europeus, e para o resto do mundo. É essa uma parte da grande missão que a Ciência Viva, há 25 anos, tem vindo a prosseguir em Portugal. Obrigada, Rosalia, e a todos os missionários e missionárias que abraçaram este desafio. Não tenham dúvidas que eu também não. O investimento na ciência e na cultura é o investimento no futuro. No futuro da Europa e no futuro do mundo. Muito obrigada pela vossa atenção.
And what a wonderful introduction to the discussion we are going to have now. And I now know that I am a missionary. So this missionary, please, is inviting our first panel, the young people, please come. So I'll start introducing you. So we have Maria João Lopes from Escola Secundária Sebastião e Silva of Oeiras, Mário Vilas, now at Instituto Superior Técnico. Oh no, sorry, he's still in the school. Yes. But you go to Instituto Superior Técnico, right? Okay, sit here, please, here. Filipe Almeida. Yes, at Instituto Superior Técnico. Teresa Viana, Faculty of Engineering of Porto. Please. And Raquel Gaião, an All-Atlantic Youth Ambassador, and now in a new Blue Investment Fund, right? Sustainable Blue Investment. I think that, yes, okay, I'll go there. So, in this first part, I will ask you, we start with Maria João, please, we are discussing your expectations, the young generation expectations on the role of science in the future of Europe. You have heard here Maria Manuela Tomarques making an overview of what is there to come, and you please say what you have been doing, and what are your perspectives, and then we will proceed one by one. Please, go ahead.
First of all, thank you for inviting me to be here. It's a great pleasure to be here with all of you, and this is a great panel. I'm Maria João, as you said. I'm a student in 11th grade in Secundaria Sebastião e Silva, Oeiras. I've competed with Mario here at the European and the after that the International Space Settlement Design Competition. This summer it was incredible. And my hopes for the future are that what if one day we woke up and the kids were as excited to do science, to join their school science club, as they were to join the football club or volleyball club or to go play PlayStation. I think that's something that we really need, because the truth is, as kids and the teens and all of us here are the future that we're going to have in 10, 20 years, or even closer than that. And that starts with the government, that starts with the school investing in us, planting the seed of curiosity in science, because it's something that we really need, like plant that seed and watering that over the years, not traumatizing the kids into science, just planting the seed of curiosity. That's something we really need. And for that, we need science to be open to non-scientists. We need to build a trust between scientists and non-scientists, so they can actually trust us, which is something that now with COVID we saw it's not there. There is not trust, and we need that trust for the future as soon as possible. So those are my hopes for the future.
And you need a school that really entices you to continue and to cultivate your curiosity to explore things and not scare you with science.
Exactly.
Right?
We are really lucky to have a great professor, teacher at our science club. She's great. She takes us to everything.
And I know.
Makes
I have
us really excited there. About doing science, being here. And I think we need a teacher like the one we have in every single school, so kids can actually be excited and excited and love doing science the same way that I do, and I bet every single one in this person, every single person in this room does.
Thank you, Maria João. Thank you very
Thank
much.
You.
Now, Mario, it's your turn. So you are still in the school. I'm sorry. Yeah.
And I'm in the 12th grade at the same school as Maria. I followed biology and economy C. Why? Because I think that we cannot divide perfectly science and like the humanitarian and economic and artistic, the other areas. We just like today we are celebrating the birth of the teacher Antonio Gideon, that was a professor, and he was also a poet. So I think that we should cooperate, just like we heard before. We need the people to create the vaccines, but we also need the people to make the process happen, like we had. And then also the people that will convince the other people to take the vaccines. Because I think that Europe should invest more, not only Europe, but especially the European Union, in communication, scientific communication. Because I think that if we create science as that very difficult and arduous thing to teach and to understand, people will not care as much to the scientific facts, and then they will hear and believe in the easiest way of talk, fake news, for example. And we have nowadays the anti-vaccines with COVID-19, and who knows what other lies they are going to create about, for example, the green and digital transition. This is it, basically. And I think that we should also create more and incentivize.
Yes, promote,
thank
yes.
you. More active citizenship projects. For example, in my school, I'm in this active citizenship project called Carbon Tree, where we are studying the air quality and the environment around us from our school. And I think that we want to show people that science is not just made for scientists. We need to make the non-scientific people in the heart of science. And I think that's it.
Thank you, Mario. Thank you for your contribution. Now, Felipe. So, Felipe Almeida is a technical.
Yes, okay. So, as you said, my name is Felipe. I'm at Instituto Superior Técnico in the final year of the Masters of Electrical and Computer Science. And I'm also an ex-participant and volunteer at CANSAT and a technical advisor in CANSAT Junior, both competitions promoted by...
You designed CANSAT Junior.
Well, let's say technical
CANSAT
advisor.
CANSAT is a space education competition that we do for the European Space Agency. And we have, jointly with Philippe and another colleague, devised a junior competition easier to make it possible for basic education students.
So. Yes, yes. So we all here present, we want the Europe to continue to be the power hub, the powerhouse and the hub for science. I think it's the main goal of everyone. So I think we need to discuss a few topics. The first one, I don't think science is spread enough. I don't think anyone knows what is going on the fields. I don't know what research is done. I don't think the general public knows about science. And I think this is a problem that we can address. Another problem is make this science available for young children. With CANSAT Junior is a small step, but I think there are other fields that can benefit from competitions like this. And the last topic, I hope that we can create a better connection between the public researchers and the private researchers, because we see that there are clearly a separation between those two parties and those two entities. So I leave four questions for the next panel. The first one is, how can we spread science among general people and among general, general people? So it's not going, we are not publishing papers on television, but how can we show, like my mom or my dad, what is done in science? What we are researching? The second question is, how can we create a better synergy between the public and the private sectors? How can we create like bonds between scientists that work in private universities and that work in public universities? And how can we create those bonds between institutes and universities and something like that? And the two last questions are, how can we motivate young people to get in research? Because I don't think it's a well-known field, and most of young people prefer to go work for a company and earn a lot of money instead of making science. And the last question, and I think it's the one that is going to create a little bit of, is, do you think that in Europe there is a lot of paperwork to make science, and how can we reduce it? Because I'm sure that Professor Fortunato would prefer making transistors with those papers instead of filling those,
on them.
Right? So do you think that this amount of paper is really needed? And how can we reduce it?
Okay, so you have left here a few challenges. I think that this interaction between public and private research, you mean companies, researchers
yes,
who are
yes.
in companies,
yes.
and researchers
research
who are
in
universities.
In school, yes.
And I think you have very knowledgeable responses from the panel, that from the scientists that are here.
Yes.
You also stressed on the need to communicate with the public. Like Mario also said, the importance of communication with the public and the importance of interdisciplinarity and not science closing on itself just with the scientists, if I understood well your statements until now. Now, so we continue with Teresa. So Teresa, please, what are your views?
Okay, now it's done. Sorry. Are you listening? Yes. So my name is Teresa. I'm 20 years old. And currently I'm finishing my bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering at PhilP. And from an early age, I've always been keen on mathematics and physics and took part in several projects, one of which was CANSAT, promoted by Ciência Viva and Ezeiro. And simultaneously, I've also engaged volunteer programs with children, with elderly people, and most recently had the opportunity to go on an international mission to Timor-Leste with the purpose of working with small children in a small community. So these are my two big passions that I like to combine and apply what I learned and what I'm still learning from both in my day-to-day life. Over the past few years, the exponential growth of science is undeniable. In our daily routine, a lot of things have become easier, faster, and even closer. I can now have a lecture from the other side of the globe. Yet, is this evolution going towards the right direction from everyone's perspective? Science nowadays, due to its fast development, has become even more exclusive. All these new technology, new digital features are only available and enjoyable to a certain people. And perhaps these despairs that we see and this accessibility to science is also promoting and exacerbating other inequalities that we see in our society in terms of opportunities, work, jobs, and perhaps also promoting the intergenerational gap that we now feel due to this digital transition. And so, as a future engineer and as an European citizen, I expect science to develop in every single direction and to reach everyone. Not only focusing on reaching the summit of technology, but also focusing on growing towards the social cohesion. And therefore, my expectations in the future for science is unity.
Thank you, Teresa. So your main concerns are about equality and integration and to make science available and understandable to all, which is also what your colleague said, but making them part of it, making them feel part of it and being integrated. And if that is not done, that risks to have incomprehensions, attritions, and problems as we have sometimes with this fake news, etc. So yes, make people, every people, part of it, make it go to everywhere, to all society. Okay, thank you very much. And now Raquel. So Raquel, you are Atlantic Youth Ambassador. You are a marine biology. You have been, but please talk about what are your expectations and your already experience.
Thank you, Anna. Yes, I have 26 years old, so I'm the oldest of this group. I'm a marine biologist, and I feel that I've been in your place in a little bit, like. You were mentioning on high school that you feel that science is not attractive enough, and I was actually on high school trying to understand what would be my career, because I had no idea. I really loved biology, and I knew I wanted to study biology, but I didn't know actually what could a biology do. Maybe I knew there were researchers that were biologists, but there are so many things that a biologist can do. Like Maria Manuel Leitão was saying, there is a department in politics that the goal is to inform the politics about science, and to do so, they need to communicate appropriately. They need to know how to communicate science to politics, and I had no idea during that time that was actually a job that you could have. And And then when I was on high school, I was like, okay, let's go to biology because I know I love to study biology. I will go there and then I will figure out. And when I was on college, I wish I had so many programs like you do now that really puts you think on the application of science, because not only it's important to simplify the science, but also to understand the application that really motivates you to go further, to continue your work. It's not the funding that will motivate you to research, or it's not like a trendy scientific scientific journal that will motivate you to make papers for the scientific journal. What I understood is that, for me at least, what worked was to understand really the application and how can science make a more sustainable world and, you know, bring technology that really solves climate issues and ocean sustainability issues. So I realized that my profile was a little bit different from my colleagues that were more research focused, and actually was with Ciência Viva from Tavira that I realized that communication was a big thing for me, and I realized that I could do communication until sunrise, doing Adobe Photoshop and Adobe Illustrator and making everything appealing and very, very interesting for the audience. So actually my path was a little bit, okay, let's go to the communication. I really love this. I like to do this. And I think I can differentiate myself from my colleagues that really do a great job in research. And it's huge. It's huge. It's very important. But I felt that I could be more useful in the communication side. And then I realized that networking and being able to connect dots was actually super, 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 super important in science. So my expectations is that the science can be, of course, like you said, communicated in different ways, but also that entrepreneurs, people that come from management, economics, look to science as an opportunity to have a competitive business that is sustainable, because science-based startups are the most sustainable ones, are really the ones that are based in evidence and that can be really, that can be grown in a fast way and be profitable. So now I work in a fund. Actually, if you ask me when I was your age that I would be working in a fund, in an ocean and climate tech fund, I wouldn't say no, that's not me, because I wanted to do biology. But now actually I'm analyzing the research behind a project, a company, and understanding how innovative it is, how sustainable it is, and they rely on me to do that. And then the investors will do will have the call to invest or not. But my job is really to understand the business model and understand the sustainability. And you need to understand science for that. So what I expect for the future is that we, in early stage, we have more openness to this type of new jobs around science and the importance for a more sustainable world.
So this is also connected to what Mario was saying about having science not closed only in science, but connecting it to other sciences, to the economy, to the arts, to other parts. And so that's what you feel you are doing now, because you are promoting, you are already in the Blue Biotech, and now in this fund you have that opportunity. So thank you very much. Now I do hope, as we have time, that there is still time for then cross questions among the panels. So I would thank you very much and call my other panel. So please. So I now call Per Edwin Persson, better known as Pelé, Zita Martins, Elvira Fortunato, and my colleague Pedro Russo, who will do a wrap-up. Oh, please, could you please be in order? So please leave that for Pedro.
Okay.
please leave that for Pedro. Yes, you here. Yes, okay, please. Here. And then Zita, and then Elvira, because of the... And then me, and we have one extra chair. Okay. So, now the parade is high, but you are up to it. So we will discuss how can science and culture meet the youngsters' expectations, and they have left some remarks also for you and some questions. So please, I think that maybe we can start with Pelle.
Thank you. And first of all, thank you for inviting me here. It's quite a challenging task.
I can be here.
I was thinking before I came that how can I prepare for this, and then I understood that actually I can't, because it's all dependent on what the previous panel will ask. I think we had a very knowledgeable panel up here. I really wish to commend the young scientists who were up here before us, because I think you asked really relevant questions and extremely important questions. And you had clearly been thinking about this, and you made very good points about the process of science. Now, part of those questions that you asked are actually perhaps not so easy to solve within science. You will need to look out from science towards the rest of society and try to find means to answer those challenges. You mentioned some of the instruments that can be used, like networking, for instance, as a very important aspect. And you also mentioned that you need communication. I think communication is really key. But if we start with the question of how can you, so to say, get people interested in science, or at least so much interested that they would know the kind of questions that are being debated. I think this is not a question of information. It is a little bit the same thing as everybody knows that smoking is not good for your health, and still some people smoke. Most people probably know that the science says that vaccination is good against certain diseases, and still we have highly educated people who say, no, I will not take a vaccination against COVID. So there are other processes involved here, and I think that is where we in science communication have not really understood the rules of the game. It's not a lack of information, it's something else. And do we really understand what factors motivate people? This is, by the way, a highly emotional question. Because you need to get people on in a way that you get them interested. And I think it really bends down to the narrative. If you have an interesting, intriguing story, if you have a mystery, if you have a kind of open question, that may be one of the venues you can use to get people on board. But it's sort of understanding that it is not really this what many people think, and many scientists tend to think, it's just a question of lack of information. We just add some more information and the situation will solve itself. It doesn't. And I think we can learn from other fields, outside science. Economics is a very good, of course, there is a scientific part to economics also, but I mean, if you think of the way in which trends are set, and how trends arise, and how you influence people in different ways. I think those are the kind of processes we need to think about. Of course, there's a lot of science to that as well, but I mean understanding the processes. Then there was several of you talked about crucial questions that we really need to think about and that we have to solve if the world is to survive, and that is addressing the inequalities in society and the inequalities in the world that relate to science also. There are so many people who are not able to get to the benefits of scientific results and scientific research. And what can we do to increase that portion? I mean, and this works at all different levels. You actually addressed all of them, or most of them, I think, in very, very eloquent manners. But if we think about, for instance, just the question of the digitalization, which of course is one of the major trends that is going on in the world today, there are people who are left out. And what can you do for those? We have similar things which work, if we look at the global scale, in medical services, for instance. We are very, very proud here in Europe that we are now more or less in many countries fully vaccinated or almost fully vaccinated against COVID. But the rest of the world is not as lucky. And especially in the developing world, we have really, really great challenges ahead. And there is not, they don't even have the mechanisms to provide the vaccination. So I mean, these are the kind of things that we really need to think about. I would like to add, how much time do I have? Can I add one more aspect?
Sure. Here?
Okay. Another aspect that I think we need to think about is also when you produce new knowledge and when you produce new technological solutions. First of all, when you produce a new piece of knowledge, it can never go away. It is not something that you can put back into the bottle if it doesn't suit you, so to say. And then the question will be, how is society, how are people and how are societies going to deal with this new knowledge and this new technology? Some of the new technologies will be very difficult or shall we say, they are almost incompatible with some of the ethical models that are prevalent in many of our societies. How are we going to deal with that? And how do we have a mechanism by which we discuss new technologies and the social implications and the social consequences of these new technologies before they are really prevalent and start sort of making things happen in our societies that we do not want to have? A very good example is this machine that most of you have. Actually, the consequences of this in terms of, let's say, child education and parenting and so on. I think there are many, many aspects that you never thought about when this technology arrived and when it was made available. And it is only when you really see how it affects our everyday life and our everyday behavior that you start asking the questions. And the mechanism to sort of be able to address those a little bit in advance and not in retrospective would be really great. I don't think the model is that we should be restrictive. I'm not saying that. Please don't misunderstand me. But it would be good if we would have a really good discussion or debate or evaluation system in society how we are going to deal with new technologies and new knowledge. I think that's these were the thoughts that came up when I was listening to this great panel that sat here before us.
Thank you. So now Zita, what do you think?
So same thing, I would like first to congratulate the previous panel. You put it beautifully and it was really nicely done and the questions were really top of the game. So, and I would like to answer or try to answer some of those questions. Science communication, then the relationship between private and public sector, and then a little bit about paperwork. Mm. So to start with science communication. How we do science communication nowadays, it's completely different how science communication was done 20 years ago, 30 years ago. I remember a couple of years ago, before COVID, I was in this panel for college students, and there were different scientists sitting there, and we were being asked by the students different questions. And one of the questions was really about what or who inspired us to become scientists. And funnily enough, all of us came from different areas. There were people from biology, physics, chemistry, etc. And all of us had a scientist that was also a science communicator. So all of us mentioned Carl Sagan, Jacques Cousteau, David Attenborough, and we could continue on and on and on. And as it was mentioned here already, it's a question of narrative. Those TV shows were not too complicated. They didn't have many sci-fi effects in there, but it was the story. It was beautifully done, and it captivated and inspired many of us to become scientists. I'm a good example of that. I'm an astrobiologist because I was really deeply inspired by Carl Sagan. And so science communication is a very important tool. It's not just a question, and as it was put on the previous panel, of showing our manuscripts and going into a journal or TV to show. No, it's not done like that. You have to break your research and translate it in a way that it's simple, and you build a bridge into the general public. And you have to do it in different sources. You have to go into television, radio, journals, Twitter, Facebook, going to schools and visiting schools all over the country, and not just high school kids. That's too late. You have to go to students that are 5 years old, 6 years old, 7 years old. That's where the passion for science actually starts. And I have my example that I would already travel the country north to the south and talked with many, many high school students. And when they're already 14, 15 or whatever, if the passion is there for science, it's there. If it's not, you can do whatever you want. It's sometimes too late. So you have to start really, really early. And there are many good examples on schools throughout the country. I've been involved in a wheat twinning project for 6-7 year old students, where the question was, this was an international program, and the question was, give us an example of a scientist that is a female. And the answer for those students for that age gap was always Marie Curie, always. And that was the only reference. And if even if you go abroad, you have exactly the same pattern. I'll give you in a few minutes the example of the UK, where I lived for many years. So this project, this e-twinning project, actually was bringing space as an example where females can live. So there were they used Samantha Cristoforetti, an Italian astronaut, because there were schools in Italy. And in Portugal, because we still don't have any Portuguese astronauts, then they asked me if I could step in and, you know, show space for very young students. And this is also an example of how science can bring together and close the gap between gender balance and everything. So it's also a very good example. But this doesn't happen only in Portugal. It also happens in the UK. I lived in the UK for 11 years, and I was funded by the Royal Society. And one of the things that they noticed was that on their headquarters in London, all the statues, all the paintings were of white male in there. So there were no females except, again, Marie Curie. So one of the projects they had while I was living there was actually to have an exhibition about female scientists. And right now I have my painting there, so they paint different paintings of different scientists, and they asked me, and it was a big honor. So every time you go now to the Royal Society, and the Royal Society is one of the oldest institutions in continuous existence, and we have a long history between the UK and Portugal. Even the foundation of the Royal Society is really connected to Portugal, and it's by simple examples that you make the difference. Just to try to close this subject of science communication, something that is also very important in science communication is that the scientists that do science communication, some are very talented, but those are extremely rare. But they have also to learn. So it's very important that they also learn how to do that. And the important thing is also
to have the scientists learn from media people. Again, right now in Portugal, we're starting to have really good examples on that. But again, on the UK, where I live for more than a decade, they had people from the BBC giving us formation, really, to learn how to communicate properly science into the different types of media, TV, radio, journals, etc. Because it's a different way, completely different way to communicate in each one of those different platforms. So that's what I want to say about science communication. In terms of bringing the private and the public sector, now I'm going to put a different hat on as co-director of the MIT Portugal program. So those questions and problems that society have, we know we have the 17 Sustainable Development Goals that that actually address the different problems we have in society right now. And on the MIT Portugal program, we have actually four different strategic areas, from climate change, sustainable cities, oceans to space, and digital transformation. So, and some of you also mentioned some of those questions. So these are really some of the strategic areas we have in this program. And the way to bring together the public sector and the private sector, so universities, research centers, and companies, those international partnerships that the MIT Portugal program is one of the examples, and there are other international partnerships, those are the ways. We have flagship projects that fund really nicely for a few years and a couple of million euros, and bring together teams from universities and research centers in Portugal with American colleagues. And so it is really important, and those are really good examples. So in the Portuguese society, we're doing this nicely, and there are already things in place to bring together the private and the public sector. If there is a long way to go, oh, definitely. There is a really long way to go. We know that we can see the numbers and how many PhDs or people with PhDs that are in companies. We know there is a long way to go, but you always have to take a first step, and those international partnerships are a really good way. And just to open also the floor for Elvira Fernat, because I'm sure she will talk about that. Bureaucracy is a massive problem, as we know, and we spend so much time filling in paperwork. Again, I just like to and try to close and not take too much time. The example I had in the UK, I receive £1 million when I was living in the UK, which is a really good grant and very prestigious. And I gave the step and the jump to become an independent researcher with that grant. And I can tell you that I had to write a proposal, very simple, a few pages, but not too much, not hundreds of pages, not at all. 5 pages of science, and then a lot of saying how much of the budget, but the science was very simple. I had an interview, which was very nice. And then each year, as an evaluation, I had to go online and click a few buttons and say, yes, I gave 3 talks internationally, I published 5 articles and then list them, something extremely simple. And they gave us a lot of money. So it is possible to receive lots of money to do top of the state-of-the-art science and not have too much bureaucracy, and have an institution that is recognized worldwide that funds really good science. So it is possible to do that. And I now close the floor. Thank you.
Thank you, Elvira.
Okay. First of all, I would like to congratulate Ciência Viva, or the PACO, as it was mentioned, and also it is a pleasure to be here, and I appreciate the invitation, and I like always to speak about science for non-scientists and also for children. Concerning your, also I agree to what was already mentioned. It was talked a lot about dissemination, and also I would like to talk just a little bit. But I would like to mention that the questions you raise are our concerns also. We are aware about what you are talking about, because also these are our concerns. And I would like also to highlight what some of you said concerning the importance of professors and the importance of professors inside the school and to drive you into science or to put your eyes, to open your eyes. And also what I would like to have is maybe some nanopacos at every school, but primary school, because it's not necessary to have this type of science or this type of demonstrations at the colleges, but at the primary school. Mm-hmm. Because even for me, this was the most important part of my life. It was the primary school. Maybe you are too young, but for example, I remember a lot of my classes at the primary school and not often the other ones when I was after 10 or 15 years old. So the primary school is very, very important, and the professors, they have an important, they are the key for the students and for all the society. Also, I agree concerning dissemination. Of course, we need to have more dissemination, but also, for example, also in Portugal, we are much better now than some years before. I don't know if it is due to COVID, because for example, now we know everyone, the society is aware about the importance of science, especially for the vaccines. But for example, even today, we are celebrating the day, the International Day of Science. And for example, in the morning, a private TV channel was inside my lab, making a direct program exactly concerning science. And this was an information and entertainment program. So the media, they are aware, more aware about science. And also, I guess, the situation we are living now concerning the pandemic and the COVID is also an opportunity to stress and to speak about the importance of science. And also, this is an opportunity. Of course, we have negative things concerning the situation we are living now, but also this is an opportunity to rise and maybe to put science, to push science to some... big to some big lights. Also, Raquel mentioned she wants to have or to see the application of science again. This type of demonstrations that we need to have inside the schools, the centers like the centers of Ciência Viva, they are playing a crucial role. In the new generations, for example, when I was a kid, this was not available for us. So I guess now you have a lot of things, and you can exploit all these science museums and all these facilities. Concerning the bureaucracy, of course, this is a huge problem in Portugal. But it's not also, I receive millions of grants from the European Commission. But the problem in Portugal is not to have, is not to succeed to have grants, is the problem to expend the money that we received from the grants. And this is related to the public administration rules. Mm-hmm. And this is, but I guess now in the future, since we are now, we will receive a lot of funds coming from the resilience program, and I guess also the government is looking for alternatives, because otherwise we don't have time enough to spend all the amount of money that is coming from Europe. So I used to be an optimist, and I guess we will succeed by sure, because we are in a very positive shape. So I don't have any other question or remark. So I agree to what was already done. But of course, dissemination is a key issue and we need to have nanopacos at each primary school. That's my message. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Elvira. That's a very good idea, nanopacos. I guess... Okay. Nano Paco, I guess that the most approximate thing we might have is science clubs. We have right now 238 science clubs in schools, so that is a sort of a Nano Paco. Mm-hmm. And we will soon.
But we need to have more. That's what they mentioned.
We need to have more. And the focus, we agree completely with your focus on primary schools. For example, in these space education things that we were talking about, the main effort in the space education here, which is done in collaboration with the European Space Agency, is in the primary school. Yeah. We have trained so far more than 800 teachers, north to south country, because the primary school teachers don't have, in general, a scientific training. And this is a huge flaw. Because, as everybody here has said, primary school is key to attract kids for science.
Yeah.
Well, but I am not a panelist myself, so I will thank you very much for your interventions. I don't know if there are any questions. Are there any questions? We have a question there.
Scientists, and that is something that relies on us, scientists, and on you, if you want to be a scientist. And the second part of this topic is, like it was said by Pelle, I guess, I'm saying the name in the right way, mm-hmm. We have a lot of information about COVID, so the problem is not lack of information. On my point of view is the way that we deal with people that don't have the right information. We could not criticize them, like in some ways we are doing. We need to teach them. We need to have patience. And that is also a characteristic of scientists. Because when you start to do science, you will see that in the full year, probably you will have 3 days with positive results. And the rest of the days, it's like looking for negative results. And here, we could apply the same principle, which is, even if people is continuously saying that they don't believe in vaccines, we should keep teaching them. And even if we take one here, we should keep trying and changing the way of doing it. And that is where we should go in the future. So thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you. I don't know if there are more questions.
For example. As escolas primárias deviam ter todas impressoras 3D.
Professora. Como é que falou? Não há mais ninguém. Não morre. Agora morre.
No more questions. You want to make some additions? Any other question? Maybe I'll take your point. It's scientists are used to communicate. They just have to get the right language, to translate their stories into the right language according to the public or to the communication media. And also, I remember that we were talking about networks. Now I make a question to you. Do you think that Ciência Viva could also have a role? Because we work with networks. Mm-hmm. We have to work in networks. It's part of our nature. To do the science centers, to do the science clubs. Do you think that we could also have a role in helping to build bridges between the scientists and the companies, the economy, the other social actors that we need for the economy? This is a bit a challenging question. Because we could promote focus groups, the testing of innovations, the testing of innovative things. We could test them with society in science centers.
In principle, yes.
The way to do it is more.
Probably.
But in principle, yes. To be more inclusive. For all the other areas.
For example, showing your paper, showing your electronic paper or something, having demonstrations. But I guess we have to proceed. Now my colleague Pedro Russo will do a brief wrap up.
One question more, please.
Ah, we have a question.
No, just a follow up of what you were asking. Maybe Ciência Viva could promote some ideation programs. I know that you focus more in primary school and earlier stages, but you know, we are sometimes. I know that now it's different from when I'm in a school, but sometimes we only memorize things and we don't push for our creativity and understanding how to apply things. So ideation. So. The process of ideate, of bring ideas to the table, even if they are very bad, it's good because you are stimulating your way of thinking how to apply something. So maybe Ciência Viva could do these ideation processes in schools, maybe high schools. I don't know if it's your focus, but you know, plant the seed so when they are in college, they can also maybe start their own company, science-based company.
Yeah, thank you. In fact, we have done some ideation sessions here, but in the framework of some European projects on marine science and on the ocean. We have done that, so we can do in other. We have done also in some space projects, but maybe this is something that we could do also on other areas because it promotes networks, it creates networks, and if done under some, let's say, under the right orientation, we could foster the appearance of new projects or a new startup, let's say, why not? That is something that we could do. And we often mix also young people and more senior people, professionals, and this gives a general, very enriching discussion. I don't know if we have questions from those who are following us online. Now would be the occasion to do the questions, but we have one more question here. Please go ahead.
Okay, so it's not a question, it was about something.
You have to speak louder, please.
Okay, sorry. You were talking about the bridges that science, Ciência Viva does, and I think you already do a great job with the bridges you build with the children in the 200 and something schools you have, because you show small kids and kids like us, we're still kids, that science is and can be fun. So in CANSAT, you show the small children that there is a big part in science is the whole, it's a whole fun of the thing. Because in school, most of us that don't, no, not me, but the most of the kids, the teens that don't like science, it's because it's boring and because you have to memorize everything. And maybe the people that decided what the teachers teach in schools have a part in that, because the programs are not fun, and science is fun. Science is.
You want to say something? I think you are dying to say something, Rosalia.
Because science means work. It's not just fun.
And need the mic.
They know that.
They know that.
I guarantee that they know that.
Even the science centers are not only fun places. No. We are making the more joinable the science, the knowledge at large. But it needs work. It needs.
They know it, Rosalia. I think that they just want to say that it doesn't need to be boring.
No, no, boring, no. We don't like boring things, like you. No, like you don't like also.
Give it the microphone. Well, for those who are following us online, there is here some agitation with the microphone because the microphone is like a ball that has been thrown. So please continue.
No, yes, of course, science is a lot of work, but in school they just show us work and you have to memorize everything about this and you have to memorize everything about the rocks and everything about things you don't really find entertaining, like you don't find it fun. And that's something that Ciência Viva does. It shows the work and the fun is the important part, because you're not going to follow something in your life. You're not going to choose something if you find it boring, because everything you're going to do in life, it's going to take work and dedication. And it's going to be, it's better if you do some work and it's fun. Than if it's just boring. And Ciência Viva shows Ciência is fun.
This is why we work with teachers also, because you can teach almost everything without being a bore. You need to, it's a question of training, of
the teachers.
Capacitation.
But what she mentioned is quite important, because also the way how we are teaching now is absolutely obsolete. We need to change drastically the way how we teach. And also this is what you are mentioning. And we are teaching exactly as we teach 100 years ago, more or less.
That's right.
Yeah.
We have another question.
And again, at the primary school. This must be done at the primary school.
We have another question back
Hi.
There.
So I'm not a scientist or anything like that. I'm actually from public administration, so nothing like science. So I think one thing that is missing in this conversation is that we have to choose between science and humanistics when we are in high school. So someone like me, that I like science, but not a lot to pursue it, I am driven apart from it from a young age, when I have to choose what I follow in school. So I think that's also missing. Why can't we have everything when we are in high school? Why can't we have like English, history, and maybe a little science from, I don't know, biology or something like that? Why can't we mix it? Why do we have to separate both parts of our lives? I think that's something that we are all missing here. Thanks.
Anna?
Another question there, and then we because we have to wrap up. Final one.
It's not a question, it's to address that comment or that question. I think like there are programs like CANSAT where it's not just the science. In CANSAT, we need to do a presentation in English. We need to publish our data, and the data needs to be pretty. It's not like a graph and that's it. No, the graph needs to be pretty. It needs to be visually pleasing. And besides that, for example, in my team, one of the years, we had a musician. Why? Well, we thought that having music during the presentation would make it better. And we had a musician in the team. So I think every field can be combined, and in schools with the right project, that separation doesn't exist. So I thought that this maybe answered your question.
So I don't know if there are final comments. Otherwise, Pedro, Pelle, please. And then Pedro actually, wraps up.
I think actually the last speaker said something very important, that all of this is connected. All of this is part of the same thing. I mean, if we think about the wicked problems of the world today, all of them have a big portion of the question is based in science, but all of them need also other kinds of knowledge and decisions. It's a question of often you have a scientific base, but then you have to think about the economic factors, you have to think about political factors, you have to think about a lot of other aspects. For instance, when it comes to world famine today, in today's world, we probably have the both the scientific and the technological knowledge needed to solve the problem, but we all know it has not been solved. And that's because of the other factors, the economy and the politics and so on. So I think it's important to think about these as a whole. There's another thing that I was sort of thinking when the discussion, you have talked now about science communication to a large extent, but I was thinking of actually adding one aspect to this question about the cooperation between the private and the public sector in science. So far, we have talked about how you get them to cooperate, which of course is a fine thing if you have a common goal. But in some cases, I think there is a conflict of interest. Mm. I somehow suspect that, for instance, Facebook would not be very willing to open up their algorithm to the rest of the world. And I mean, for public research, I think one of the important principles, at least in Finland, is that it has to be published in open access. It has to be available to everyone. And I think that is something that in the private sector does not always prevail as the philosophy. So there are things that we need to think about, how these are going to be solved. I am all in favor, of course, of doing as much cooperation as possible, but we should be aware of that there might be areas where we need to have a really deep discussion about how to go on.
So there are limitations. Pedro, so you wrap up.
Yes, I'll try to be as short as possible.
Because we are coming to the end of the session.
And of course, I'd like maybe to go through some of the main points that I think all the panelists addressed. And there was a lot of interesting content, and I think quite relevant for the big question that we have here: what if science was at the heart of the development of Europe? So I think that's very important to address. And of course, we started with our member of the European Parliament, Maria Manuela Marques Leitão, where she also was showing some interesting aspects of how the European Parliament is looking at governance based on evidence. Evidence-based governance is essential. I think the pandemic is a very good example, how we need to have evidence, scientific evidence, to support decision-making at the political level. And I think it was good to hear that Europe is trying to get ready for that and really learning from best experiences. And also touching what Pella was saying now, that most of the societal challenges that we have now in Europe, the way that we address them needs to be with science. We need science to really tackle those challenges. So science is really, really important. The young panel, but I think the points that they brought was really at the highest level that I've seen. I think you touch most of the fundamental aspects that we have of science and society and the role of science and society. So thank you so much for that. And I'll highlight some of them. Of course, Maria João really talked about the importance of science to be open, aspects of open science, that we know that our minister is very also important, keen. But the open science is not only open publications, it's really making sure that society is part of science. And I think that was the role that you're trying to make, or the point that you're trying to make. Philippe talked about that science is still is still very much in silos, right? We have these silos, we have the labs, we have the institutions. We need to open up, we need to break, we need to really have science more present in science, and science to be more available. I think Mario said something very interesting. Mario said that something that was non-scientific people need to be at the heart of science. This is beautiful. We need to bring really the non-scientists to the heart, to the core of science. And I think it's really, you touch on a very important aspect of what science needs to be in the future. A science that serves society, science that is done with with society, and really looking at that aspect. Teresa, maybe from your experience in Timor,
you pose a question that is also very relevant. What is more important? Development of science, development of technology, or making sure that we bring society along in that development? And that's one of the questions that we have, because we can keep exploring and making new technologies and new new research, but what if we are leaving all these people behind? That cannot happen. We need to make sure that that doesn't happen. Mm-hmm. And Raquel, now with your new position, looking at science as a value creator. I think science can create value in society, economical value as well, and the science that is social responsible can also create value, and I think that's also key. And I could stop here. I think you touched most of the key points of the role of science in the future of Europe. But let's just very quickly, new points. Pelle talked about the public engagement with science, that we need to move from the deficit model. We need to have public engagement that maybe is even emotional public engagement. We need to go beyond facts and education. We need to have more different type of engagement with science. Zita also said that scientists need to do the work. They need to get out. They need to talk. They need to go to the schools, be present. And we know that the public wants the scientists to be present. We know that. That information, we are very much aware. So scientists need to get out of the labs and really be present and be role models. Be role models, because one day the kids that are going to be talking with, they want to become like them. And they need to see women. They need to see minorities, people historically disengaged with science. They need to see themselves represented in that people. Elvira talked about the nanopacos that, of course, we as a Ciência Viva board, we are very happy. But indeed, the clubs Ciência Viva, the science clubs in the schools are a bit of our nanopacos. And hopefully in the next years, we're going to have more than 800. It's not still every single school, but hopefully we're going to very, very very getting to the point that we get every single school. And because it's already late, let me just finish with this that I think was said in different ways. There is no Europe without science, but there's also no science with scientific culture. And I think in the day that we are celebrating the National Day of Scientific Culture, this is an essential point. Science only exists if society supports, if society understands, and if society participates in this in science. And I think that's extremely important. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So thank you all. And I now call our Minister of Science and Technology, Manuel Leitor, to make the conclusion.
Muito boa tarde a todas e a todos e sobretudo àqueles que estão à distância. Thank you very much for those that are participating, particularly online. This is the fourth session of a series of events we have started to organize in July after the Portuguese presidency of the European Union, when the Conference for the Future of Europe was launched. And the objective is essentially to discuss the future of Europe. What we want out of Europe, and essentially how can we make science for Europe and Europe for science. And essentially, we put together this booklet that is outside, and we remember the idea of utopia brought about 500 years ago by Thomas More. And essentially, Thomas More, followed by a number of other intellectuals, including Erasmus de Roterdão and Damião de Góis, by that time, they address the key issues facing Europe in the 16th century, after a very troubling 15th century, and essentially the beginning of slavery together with the discoveries. And they launched an humanitarian process called by the European humanism, which essentially is the founding principles of the building up of Europe. Actually, over the last week, concluding tomorrow, we have published 6 of these books from the founding fathers of the European thinking and the foundations of the European process, but essentially Utopia was a very important process, like the others, Erasmus de Rotterdam, the Elogio da Loucura, among other pieces of work. What Thomas More says is that the Utopia for some creates dystopia for others, and this idea that we have an ideal world is not a unique context. If we bring this discussion to science, many have addressed this question of the dialogue. In Portugal, we all are, all our thinking was based in our modern thinking of science on José Maria Negago, but even himself brought to Portugal and to Europe the lessons of John Zimmermann about 60 years ago, where he first addressed this after the Second World War and brought the discussion that science is social, and for being social is very complex. It does not appear overnight. And this question that actually we launch, what if, which is the question that Thomas More launched 500 years ago, is actually what if every single European citizen is part of new scientific developments? And this question is particularly important. But here today in Ciência Viva, we are always surprised with new ideas, new things. And when I entered today, I was particularly surprised with this COVID book, which is very interesting and actually brings together five issues, which at the end are all about what if make a scientific Europe, and what if we guarantee that all European citizens understand science. Certainly, this is a cultural issue. It is not only a scientific issue. It's above all a question of the way we respect each other, the way we see each other. So essentially, it's a cultural issue. And actually, earlier today, Rosalia presented here to all of us the results of the Eurobarometer. And we should be proud that after 25 years of Ciência Viva, we are in the top of the scientific culture, but we should also be very worried, very concerned, to see how diversified is the scientific culture of European citizens. If you go to other countries in the south or north or eastern or western Europe, there are a quite large diversity between different European regions how people understand science. So this is really a key issue, the cultural dimension of science in the way that everyone understands that science is part of culture. The second question is observation. Certainly, this is not, again, a new question, it's an old question, but it's one that we need more and more to do. We need data, we need to observe better, we need to observe ourselves and to observe the others, and the observation is always critical. Certainly, we know that the third word is verdade, true. John Zimmermann launched this first book about science, about real science, and then the second book about reliable knowledge, because this idea that science is always looking for truth, and essentially building up reliable knowledge is a critical issue, particularly we understood it through COVID. We don't know, and we are experimenting at a world level, a large lab of how to face a COVID and to speed up this run and this incredible run for getting truth. And we know that apart from that, we have understood over the years, particularly over the last 50 years, that science can also create walls. And this is innovation. How can we add value or create value? Or how, above all, companies, firms, entrepreneurs create value by adopting change, particularly change driven by science, and this is certainly to innovate, to create value. But today we know more than ever that we need to be very careful to create value, but a value which is sustainable in terms of the environment. And this is the question of environmental sustainability together with the social dimension. So I found these debates which are going on during this week, these COVID debates, particularly important because overall the best way is this dialogue to engage each other, certainly by exchanging views and by mobilizing each other, we can certainly help this pathway to a better Europe. But overall, this set of events, starting in Porto in July, then in Bragança, Coimbra last month, and today here, to be concluded in the National Day of Scientific Culture, are essentially aimed to bring more people, all of you and others, to send your ideas to Ciência Viva and to this Conference on the Future of Europe to guarantee that science is in the future of Europe. And again, I thank you, Ciência Viva, for opening up this debate. But please note that we want the future of Europe with science and scientific culture. And although these are related terms, they are very much different from each other. Today, we are in the National Day of Scientific Culture. To my knowledge, Portugal is the only country that have a National Day of Scientific Culture. We have also other day for the scientists themselves, the 16th of May. But these two terms are different from each other, and certainly we need science, we need more science, and we know that to have science we need scientific culture, but we cannot ask every single citizen to be a scientist, and we should not. Scientists is more and more a given and a very specialized profession, and people have the right to choose other professions and other type of careers. And therefore, this need to understand the difference and the commonalities of science and scientific culture brings about what some of you have also addressed. We need professionals of scientific culture, people that are not necessarily scientists, but understand this dialogue and make these bridges. And certainly, particularly in our country, we have understood over the last 25 years how important it is to have scientists, to have professionals of scientific culture, and essentially to have, to understand this critical role of promoting the so-called ciência viva, and therefore to have the scientific culture. At the same time, we open up the minds of our scientists and our citizens at general. But please, enjoy the end of the National Day of Scientific Culture with Ciência Viva, and try and make sure that you take more people promoting your own ideas in the Conference of the Future of Europe. Thank you very much.